first time you fall in love, you're sure it's going to last forever.
I wonder if maybe seeing so much of each other is really such a good thing.
Painful, beautiful, Liza Minnelli and the Sterile Cuckoo.
Tomorrow night at 9 on ABC.
Former Nixon aide Ron Ziegler came out swinging today against critics of his former boss. And a missing Riverside boy has been found near Los Angeles. He's been reunited with his parents.
An earthquake jolts Southern California, but is more frightening than destructive. And Pittsburgh football fans celebrate in the streets as the Steelers take Super Bowl IX.
Also tonight, Leo McElroy with a film report on the latest furniture fashions. And Wayne Satz follows a 30-mile war tax protest march. Next on Eyewitness News.
Louise, honey, this is noon. A little lunch from Del Monte's. Little lunch. I'll put it with a small salami.
It's made from yogurt.
I'll put it with the yogurt.
It's made from yogurt.
I'll put it with the yogurt.
But don't put it with the yogurt. Yogurt never tasted like this. Comes in raspberry, blueberry, strawberry, pineapple, and peach.
Put it with a banana.
I'll put it with a banana.
Nutritious. You eat it at lunchtime.
We eat it at lunchtime.
You don't have to have a big lunch to have a good lunch with new little lunch products from Del Monte.
Sam,
I'm putting it away.
Folks, the deals are fantastic at the Car Clearance Carnival. This week only, buy or lease a 75 Plymouth Duster or Dodge Dart Swinger. Make your best deal with the dealer, and then Chrysler Corporation will send you $200 on top of that. And hey, here's a trade-in bonus. If you own any Pinto or Vega, come down by Wednesday. Trade for that new Duster or Swinger, and we'll send you another $100. It's a carnival of values at your Dodge and Chrysler Plymouth dealers.
Where they're buying your physical presence. They think that they're buying, I think, a piece of flesh that's deep, that looks a certain way in terms of what they're trying to market. They're not buying the thing that makes you like Christmas. They're not buying the thing that makes you like your six-month-old daughter. They're buying something totally divorced from that. So when you really think of that, when you really probably, I haven't thought of that, nor, I mean, there's certain things, it hurts in a kind of searing way, you know.
Robin doesn't just sit around feeling bad. He's too active for that. He's just 30, but he knows no matter what shape he keeps himself in, modeling is only temporary. Robin wants to be an actor. So did every male model we've talked to. He works at it. A 3-mile jog before breakfast tones the body, and when there's no modeling assignment, he reads for parts or studies acting. He's done some bit roles in TV shows. There are some strong statements in the paintings that line the walls of his canyon home, but they are done by Robin's wife, Carla, whom he met while on a modeling assignment in Italy. Their 6-month-old daughter is probably the most literate child in her neighborhood. Robin reads to her every morning English romantic poetry.
Well, how do you feel about your job, Robin? How do you feel about being a male model?
I'm sorry you asked that. I think there's, well, I would rather do that than work in a bar.
What do you think is the reason that you're so successful?
I don't, I'm not sure I am, or I wouldn't have been so sheepish when you asked that. I mean, I got real shy there. I think it's because I can evoke, I can create an emotion in my face. Whether it's through, whether I have to say something and it's in a television commercial, it happens to be a still photograph. I mean, I can make something erupt into my face that's believable, real, and decent. Whether he's happy because he's sitting with a pretty girl drinking a scotch, or he's, you know, enjoying nature with some kind of green cigarette or whatever. But I mean, that's the thrill in it. I mean, if there is one, that you can do that, that you can really do that, you feel real.
There are about 1 million kids under the age of 18 that run away from home every year in this country. Back in the mid-1960s, many of those young people headed for San Francisco and Haight-Ashbury. But now in 1975, there are runaways just about everywhere.
There are about the same number of runaways in San Francisco as in any other city of its size. Running away is no longer the lure of one special city. It's simply the need to get away from home. And every year, as many as 1 million people under 18 do this. There's no one reason. Some may leave because their parents literally throw them out. Others may just take off for a few days. But in most states, it is illegal, and juveniles can be arrested. Statistics on runaways are sketchy. It's hard enough to spot who is or who isn't a runaway, and most of those who are tend to go underground when they reach their destinations. Major cities now have private agencies working underground to provide housing, food, and medical services for runaways. The first such place in the country was San Francisco's Huckleberry House. Leslie and Mark are both 17. They live here now. Mark is a recent runaway. Leslie is a seasoned veteran.
I was 13, and I left because of me and my mom didn't get along, and I was always a loner. I never really had anybody to talk to.
I left home a week ago, and the reason for leaving was because my father and I were always disagreeing and fighting, so I decided to leave.
A number of families may want to say, all is forgiven, please come home. But if the runaway doesn't call or write, what can a parent do? A Chicago runaway agency found an answer, a toll-free national hotline that puts runaways and parents in touch. It is a toll-free number that any parent or any runaway can call from anywhere in the country and talk directly to each other if they wish. If not, runaways can have messages telephoned to their parents.
Okay, the message is, I'm okay, don't worry. It will take a while to work things out. I haven't reached my destination yet, and I will call you when I'm ready to. Tell my sister I love her too.
We should point out that this was a fictitious message to a fictitious parent. But the National Runaway Switchboard, as it's called, handles several hundred real calls between parents and runaways every day. Ultimately, this may mean some children will go home, but not all of them. Many may not care to. Many aren't welcome if they do return. But at least there is a way for parents and runaways to get in touch now, a way that doesn't reveal a runaway's whereabouts to parents or police, and a way that might, for some, lead home.
Come back to me in shades of mediocrity, like emptiness and harmony. I need someone to comfort me. Homeward bound, I wish I was homeward bound. Home, where my thoughts are escaping. Home, where my music's playing. Home, where my love lies waiting.
The Great Western Feeling. At Great Western Savings, you get the strength of assets over $4.5 billion. The highest interest you can find anywhere on insured savings, and so much more. You get the feeling that comes from knowing you put your savings in exactly the right place. That's the Great Western Feeling.
Hello, I'm Helen Hayes. There's something very exciting happening in this country. Thousands of people throughout the United States are actively involved with the American Field Service, AFS.
They are volunteering their time to help high school students from 60 nations understand more about our country. AFS deserves to be a part of your town or city. Write AFS, 313 East 43rd Street, New York, New York.
If you leave your keys in your car, you're not alone. Thousands of Southern Californians do the same thing every day. In fact, if all the keys left in all the cars by Southern California drivers each year were placed end to end, they'd make it all the way to the state line. Some of the cars make it there, too. Or try to.
We are 9 years away, 9 years away from 1984. I find that almost hard to believe. Writer George Orwell made that year famous in his science fiction novel about Big Brother. But as we're going to see in this report from Steve Mallory, what Orwell wrote about in the 30s might not be all that far-fetched in the 70s.
George Orwell's 1984 is a place in time where man has finally adapted technology to repress man. Columbia Pictures released its film version of the book in 1956. The West is a totalitarian state. The leader, Big Brother, is always watching. Society is almost sterile. Individuality and freedom have been sacrificed. Science is directed toward developing more proficient ways to make war. The government uses technology to protect itself from the people and alien forces. Today, there are several who think many of Orwell's visions have come to pass, and that the outlook for the future isn't all that bright.
In no way have our war scientists shirked the Orwellian challenge. Orwell predicted secret doomsday research towards development of the ultimate thermonuclear weapon. And in the farthest fling of his wildest imagination, he predicted the following adjuncts to war research: a lens in space to focus the heat of the sun's rays on the enemy, and creation in the laboratory of new breeds of disease immunized against all possible antibodies.
Professor David Goodman is a biopsychologist and a futurist. 2 years ago, he and an associate identified 137 prophecies in Orwell's 1984. He says 100 of them have been realized already. For example, in 1949, Orwell wrote that police helicopters would be used for surveillance, that in war, helicopters would be used as gunships, there would be radio-controlled bombs and defoliants. That all came to pass in Vietnam. 1984 had thought police who try to determine who will commit a crime by interpreting body movements and expressions. Orwell refers to the practice as a body science named face crime, similar to what guards attempt at airport security checkpoints. Snooper TV cameras are virtually everywhere in the Orwellian future. Now, for security reasons, TV monitoring systems are increasing in number. Orwell referred to massive computer systems which collected information about individuals. Today, both private and government agencies do that.
We don't have more than, I'd say, 3 to 5 years to pass the necessary legislation to avert that Orwellian 1984. There was a study done by the Stanford Research Institute